Suda, can I have one more word with you?
Yeah.
When we do the talking points, could you like type them here?
Okay.
Right? So while I...
Okay, but I need to change the screen for that though.
Yeah, yeah, not now. Not now. We're not going to start there. Okay. Not now. Okay. Well, welcome everybody. In this somewhat unusual format for this class, but as you know, we're streaming this class session, and I appreciate everybody being okay with that and participating in that. Our topic for this class today is sociological institutionalism. And I would like to actually start with a brief recapitulation of where this topic fits within the larger structure of the class. We spent last session, or rather Professor Andonova spent last session, talking about one particular form of institutionalism, which he called liberal institutionalism. Now the starting point for liberal institutionalism is the puzzle of cooperation, what I would call the puzzle of cooperation. Why do states cooperate? That problem is a problem if you start from the premises of realism, right? Because realism tells us that states are self-interested, that states seek to pursue power, and as a result, the image is one of states being positioned against each other, states being located in an anarchist environment, which to begin with you would say, well, that's states would not necessarily then work with each other, right? They're not altruistic. They don't say they're not members of a family that would be collaborating with each other. Yet, de facto, as we look at the 20th century international system, there's a lot of collaboration going on between states. For realists, that's a problem. And so there is actually a series of different answers people have provided to the question as to why states collaborate. I put up here three theories of regimes, I call them, because regimes are essentially about collaboration. And these different types of theories provide potential answers to the question of why do states collaborate? Okay. Power-based, interest-based, knowledge-based. You know some of this stuff. So I would like to actually invite you at this point, Germe, don't shake your head. I would like to invite you at this point to tell me your understanding of what a power-based theory of international regimes would say. So if the purpose of, or if cooperation can be explained by reference to power, what would such an explanation look like? Yes, Anna Maria. Microphone, please.
Okay, so I would imagine that the power-based approach says that practically regimes allow the states to multiply their power by engaging in cooperation and then projecting this power to other states more weak that are engaged in this cooperation. So,
such as, for example?
Well, for example, the European Union, let's say, after the dislocation of ancient colonies, the states were not at the level of the great powers. Actually, after the Second World War, there are no great powers in Europe. but by engaging in cooperation in the European Union, they are expecting to multiply their power. So,
fantastic. Yeah, beautiful example. So here is a set of states who have decided that they are going to cooperate with each other in order to actually gain more power. Cooperation provides them with more power. Now, so is there a potential problem in there, though? Are realists then basically wrong when they say states wouldn't necessarily cooperate because what happens, let's stay with the European Union, well, in the end, isn't it perhaps the case that Germany gains more than others? And wouldn't that be then a problem from a realist perspective? How do power-based theories deal with that potential effect? Yes, can we have the Pablo?
Realism considers that states think in relative terms, think power in relative terms, not in absolute terms. So they're not motivated to absolute gains of power for each one, but they are concerned on the relative gains of power of every single actor. And if the other has more power, then it doesn't matter how much power I gain. If the other gains more, then it's increasing the level of power, and because of that, is increasing my insecurity. So this is a problem in realism. This is the basis of the model of Waltz. So it shouldn't happen. Yeah. But it could happen if we explain the system or the regime based on the asymmetries of power. So if there is an asymmetric power that is interested in providing some collective goods to the system, but not being the only one responsible for providing these goods, because in economical terms, it's better to share the burden. So in this case, the hegemon will create the regime, and because of the asymmetries of power, yep, it will be more like bandwagoning for the others, and the hegemon will make the rules and the norms of the regime, mm-hmm, be respected by coercive power in some cases, but also by affirmative incentives.
Soft power, right? Yeah. So. Thank you very much. Beautiful, right? Beautiful answer. So there were two elements, two things that Pablo said. One thing was it's relative power that matters, right? So theoretically, if I go back to Anna Maria's example of the European Union, if it's really true that Germany would gain so much disproportionately from the European Union that the relationship between Germany and France maybe might be such that that the relative power relations change fundamentally, realism would tell us, or power-based theories would tell us, that cooperation would fall apart, that it wouldn't ultimately matter. But then there is that second element of what Pablo said, right, which is that there is a hegemon. And realists tell us cooperation happens if there is a hegemon who has an interest in the overall order of the system and will therefore establish rules that increase the overall well-being, usually the hegemon gaining more than others, but is able to implement that kind of rule system because of both different capabilities in terms of power, but also in different types of power, right? Coercion as well as consent is how Gramsci would put that. Okay, so power-based theories. it's basically realist theories of cooperation, which have limits. I mean, it's not a very satisfactory explanation of the phenomenon of the European Union, for example, because the European Union actually has now continued to exist for at least 55, 60 years. So there is all kinds of stuff going on there that realism can't actually tell us. Interest-based theories. These are the theories that Professor Andonova talked about last week. Let's just recapitulate those really quickly, and I don't want any big answers there here now. What are some of the key issues that we need to remind ourselves that interest-based theories assume, and how do they explain cooperation? I just want kind of quick. Let's do more of a brainstorming than an extensive elaboration here. So, what is it that you remember from last week's lecture? Kasia.
Professor Andonova started with a game, with an exercise with the game theory. So we then realized that the states would rather cooperate when they know the game than compete with each other.
Yep. Okay. Perfect. So that was the one. That was Axelrod's theory of cooperation that gradually, over through reiteration and iteration of the game of prisoner's dilemma, ultimately you actually do achieve cooperation. And the key issue is here: states actually learn, in a sense, right? This is not Axelrod's explanation, but there is a memory that states have from the previous round of having played, so that over time, tit for tat is the strategy that wins out. What else? So implied here, by the way, is kind of cooperation is natural. In the end, it's actually not a puzzle. It's what we should end up with. Laurie, Kershia, could you pass it back?
The theories also mentioned that regimes reduce the asymmetry of information and uncertainty. So it would be a rational, it has like an instrumentalist function for states mm-hmm. to cooperate because they will gain more information and increase their payoffs over time.
Yeah. So really important here that the easy answer is it's in the interest of states to cooperate, of all states, because the overall gain would be larger if they cooperated. And the way to get there, as Laurie says, is by reducing transaction costs, by providing good information, by making it possible to overcome that prisoner's dilemma that Axelrod identified as a problem. So in a way, regimes make it easier then to have this movement towards cooperation happening. But the point is interest, and the other element of that theory that Robert Cohen puts forward, of course, is that this is functional, right? So it's functional to an overall result. Okay, interest-based theories. Now, what in my typology here is from an article by Hasenclever and others. And they suggest that there's a third type of theory, and they call that knowledge-based theories. And let me just give you a little introduction on what some of those theories might look like. There's a slew of different authors who have written about these types of theories. They include also Cohen, who's written a book with Goldstein about the role of ideas in international affairs, and they are suggesting that ideas actually provide different kinds of resources that make it possible to collaborate. They provide roadmaps, so having certain kind of knowledge about how things happen and not other kinds of knowledge directs actors, state actors, in a particular direction. Ideas provide focal points, and they specifically talk here about game theory again, and in particular about games that have no one logical solution. If you then have ideas, they can provide what game theorists call the saddle point, and it allows people to actually come around certain issues. Let me give you an example. I mean, if we are thinking about the prisoner's dilemma, for example, again, let's assume that there's actually ideas and norms out there that say you shouldn't rat on each other, which is actually a pretty strong norm in some criminal circles. You know, you just don't rat, and if you rat, bad things are gonna happen to you, whether in jail or outside jail. Well, if that's the understanding, then the logical solution to the prisoner's dilemma is perhaps not to rat on each other and not cooperate, but the logical solution may be precisely to cooperate, because that's what the norms, the ideas that are out there, that's what those things tell you. There's also theories that focus on, or that suggest that institutions learn, both institutions and organizations, I should say here, learn. Ernst Haas is one of the people who is associated with this kind of theorizing. Haas studied extensively the European Union. The European Union is obviously a prime example of cooperation. And he developed, for example, the notion of spillover that you may have heard. So that's the functionalist idea that if you start cooperation, that there is a spillover from one issue area to another issue area, and so there is kind of this evolution of cooperation that happens. The idea behind that is that there is a learning process going on, that organizations learn, that there's an imitation effect going on, and things of that nature. Haas also talked about organizational learning, so organizations do things as the environment changes, and so they adapt themselves to that environment in different ways, in a creative fashion, in a less creative fashion. But there's processes happening in cooperation. And then we also should point to Peter Haas's theorizing on epistemic communities. His work is primarily in the area of the environment, and he asked the question, how do environmental regimes get created? And one of the answers, or the answer that he provides, is that you actually need a certain kind of knowledge. You have to have some causal knowledge about causes and effects, so that there is people who provide that knowledge network with political actors to form an epistemic community, a community that agrees on a particular cause-effect relationship, that agrees that, for example, that the ozone hole is a result of having chlorofluorocarbons in the atmosphere, and so that therefore an intervention needs to be made. And if you have the knowledge around, and that knowledge is shared, you will this will result in cooperation, in particular if the problem is very specific, right? Haas talks about this distinction between knowledge about the ozone hole, for example, as opposed to knowledge about climate change, which is a lot more contested, and as a result, you haven't had that kind of a coming together to the in the formation of a regime, or it is a lot more difficult to arrive at agreements. So in all of these instances, knowledge is the key element that explains cooperation. We then, and you have encountered these in various ways, have theories about norms going through cycles, about norms being established and then cascading and spreading around the world, and this is work by Finnemore and Sicking. You have other work that talks about the power of identity, about the idea that states actually have an identity and that their interests are related to their identity, to their to their sense of who they are. So if you have an identity of being part of the West or Western state, it will influence the way in which you conduct yourself vis-a-vis other Western states, or how you conduct yourself in the world, what kind of alliances you will join, and so on. And then I'm gonna just hint again to the English school, because many of these ideas are, of course, not new at all to the English school, which basically starts from the premise that there is a social environment out there, that states share norms, that states share, that the international realm is institutionalized. So this is not entirely strange to them at all. And we arrive here, I started out with the puzzle that institutionalism, that liberal institutionalism is trying to address. The puzzle is one of how and why do states cooperate? Why should they? And that becomes a puzzle if your worldview is realist. If your worldview comes from the English school, and you think of the international world as institutionalized, the international world as operating according to norms, then cooperation actually is not really that much of a puzzle. And you actually start to ask different kinds of questions. I wanted to give you this overview because the two readings that I assigned for this week are not exactly squarely in any of those bodies of knowledge-based theories that I talked about here, but they are both influential writings, and I would like for us to discuss these theories in the context of this broader understanding that is out there about international institutions. So we had two readings, right? We had a reading by Martha Finnemore, really a review of various books coming from the world culture tradition that has, or sociological institutionalism that is associated with sociologists at Stanford, and that she did a lot to appropriate into international relations. And then we talked, you read the article by John Ruggie about embedded liberalism, which talks about the social purposes of regimes. I would like to switch now from lecturing to moving to our standard seminar style discussions. I hope this is going to work here. And I would like to invite Tudor to take over the podium here and note the talking points. So I'm gonna switch to, that kind of microphone. Thank you very much. And I'd like you to pull out your notes, your class notes, and tell me what you think is worth talking about in terms of the readings that you read, or what you found difficult that we need to maybe clarify. And so let's do a collection of these issues. Who wants to go first? Guilherme. Do we have the other microphone?
Right, so my remarks were largely inspired by last week's events. because I think they marry well with what Rogi and Fenimore had to say. It may be a bit too early to make this kind of first conjecture, but well, anyway, we could try and solve the problem as soon as possible. I was wondering if the U.S. election might culminate in a norm-transforming change, to use a term borrowed from Rogi.
Okay.
Which, of course, would presuppose a change in legitimate social purpose before.
Great question. Yes, thank you.
Can I do one more?
You have another one?
Okay. Yeah, well, I have a few more, but just another one. If embedded liberalism still manages to survive, who will then bear the adjustment costs? Rogi outlines three possible candidates. That's inflation. Well, better saying everyone who's affected by inflation, so mainly the poor, the private sector, or regime takers. Thanks.
Okay. Who will bear the costs of embedded liberalism, or of change of
the maintenance
of the maintenance of embedded liberalism? Okay. Anybody else? Yes. Let's get the microphone down. Remind me of your name.
Atisha.
Yes.
I had a question. Are intersubjective health social purposes norms in the conventional sense of the world, or can they be just easily understood as shared in interest?
So intersubjectively shared social purposes, is that what you said?
Mm-hmm.
Social purposes, can they just be understood as norms? That's the question.
Can they be just understood as shared interests?
Or shared interests,
yes.
Yeah. Social purposes and shared interests. Okay, that's a great question. Thank you. Damilola.
Yeah, I just wanted to know, because Fenimore was arguing against the institutionalists in terms of the global cultural rules. So I want to know how valid her claim about cultural norms are being established by force or fiat against the institutionalist argument of cognitive process of institutionalization of cultural rules, considering that nations are gradually becoming westernized, in quote, without coercion.
Okay. So
how cultural norms established?
Yeah, cultural norms and the role of power in this is really Fenimore's critique.
Yeah.
Okay. Who else? Laurie.
Similarly for Fenimore's text, I was wondering, she claims that rationality is a feature of the Western culture. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering if that's not a bit Eurocentric view. I mean, is it more about modernity and technicality?
Okay. So rationality, a feature of Western culture, or versus modernity as the basis of world culture? Is that what you're getting at? Okay. Anybody else? Jane.
So my question refers to Rogi's text. As I understood, he develops embedded liberalism, which takes in the dimension of social purpose,
mm-hmm.
and that characterizes the international economic order. So, I understood that the states face a trade-off between free trade and also like the power to intervene into the economic order, and also, for example, to provide welfare programs. And so my question is, how can states reconcile the desires for a free market system without losing their autonomy to intervene into the economic or into the market, and also steer, for example, welfare-based domestic policies?
Mm-hmm.
this is an economic question, isn't it? Right? It's a really a question. Well,
It's about the autonomy and also the power to intervene also. So
yeah. Okay. Okay. All right. Yes, Nicolas.
Yes, thank you. I was wondering whether, and if yes, to what extent can Rogge's embedded liberalism be seen as a social structure as understood by Finmore?
Ah, wow. Okay. Nice. Okay. Katarina.
I just wanted to ask, since I read that Finmore writes that participation in international organization construct or constitutes what state want, or in the case of European Union participation, what they are, to what extent this statement could be considered correct, because I think that it's like a little bit strong say that international organization say that what they are, what states are. Mm-hmm. I mean,
okay. International organizations say determining what states are.
Okay.
Yeah, especially in the European Union.
Okay.
Context.
Especially in the EU context. Alicia.
I also had another question on why didn't the international free trade regime fall when the hegemon's power ended, as predicted by the hegemonic stability theory.
Mm-hmm. So why didn't the international trade regime fall, as predicted by hegemonic stability theory?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
As predicted by?
By hegemonic stability theory. Cecilia.
Finnemore talks about this assimilation of norms to the extent that they're taken for granted. And I was wondering if that is comparable to a certain extent to what we read about Pulio saying about the development of shared practices, because I found that quite similar. Maybe at a different level of analysis, but a comparable process.
Mm-hmm. So norms, are norms similar to shared practices in Pulio's sense? Yeah. All right. Kershia.
In the Finmore reading, I realized that it couldn't really explain poverty of, the poverty in countries that are in very bad situations. So I wanted to know by their lack of understandings, those countries, would it be fair to say that sociology institutionalism is not effective in challenging liberalism and realism in IR theories?
Mm. Interesting question. So sociological institutionalism, can it actually change liberalism?
Yeah.
You'll have to explain that again. There was more in what you said, but let's just put that up now. Damilola.
Yeah, I was also wondering that since institutionalism talks about norms, cultures, and the inverted agent structure, so instead of agent structure, you have the structure and the agent.
Yeah.
So I was wondering if we can say that the sociologist or the institutionalist can also be called constructivists.
Okay.
I don't know.
All right. Okay. Sociological institutionalists, are they constructivists? Okay. Guilherme, one more.
So yeah, I was going to keep quiet, but based on what Kershia said, I was wondering how well does Finnemore conceptualization of progress versus justice apply? This may extend to Jane's question as well.
Okay. So progress versus justice?
So economic accumulation versus equality.
We don't have our questions group now, right? This is becoming a little more difficult. But that's all right. Okay. Thank you very much, Tudor. Very nice job. I think we should probably... Let's start with the Finnemore text, right? And I would like to start, well, let's start with 12. Is sociological institutionalism constructivism? Anybody? Yeah, I'm going to give you my microphone again so that we have one on each side of the room.
I kind of understand where she's coming from, but I think there is an ontological difference, whereas constructivism, it assumes states as agents. Meanwhile, in sociological institutionalism, they assume the structure. They don't really give importance to agency. So I don't think it is.
You think that they may be sociologists, but they are not constructivists?
Yes, mainly because of the epistemological difference.
Very
of those theories.
Okay, so it's too structuralist for you to really think. It's too much like Waltz, is that what you're saying, right? Because Waltz is a structuralist, presumably, right? Well, what's the difference then?
I'm not saying that they're completely, well, they do seem similar because of the argument over society's influence, but at mm-hmm. the base of it, you can see the different assumptions uh-huh. that form these two theories.
Okay.
So I would follow on that.
Interesting. Cecilia.
Yeah, I totally agree with you, but I also think that they really account for change, which is a major feature of constructivism. So you can really see how reality in the social institutionalist perspective is very much fluid, and cooperation is not fixed but actually evolves over time. And there is this whole focus on interactions, and that, in my opinion, is very much constructivist.
Ah, so contradiction. They are constructivist. And it's because there is actually movement there. There is something happening, right? That idea of imitation of norms spreading, of isomorphism being generated. Celia, yeah?
Yeah, and also this fact that ideas are actually assimilated and become part of one's identity, probably,
all right.
and shared, and
right.
therefore they create a shared identity to a certain
uh-huh.
extent.
Okay, so the internalization of norms. Guilherme, did you have your hand up?
Maybe add a few points. I completely agree with Kush, actually. I think you provoke her by saying, oh, isn't Waltz a structuralist? But, you know, a few classes ago, you just said Waltz actually takes a very much agent-based approach. So, and I changed my mind. I tend to agree with you now. I'd just like to point out that Fenimore actually writes that institutionalist inattention to agency leads them into more serious errors. It leads them to misspecify both the mechanisms by which social structure produces change and the content of the social structure itself. So, well, she's clearly outlining here what Kirsha said. So, you know, props to her.
So the problem is maybe with the sociological institutionalists and not with Fenimore? Is that what you're saying?
Well, if we take Fenimore as an authoritative source, I think so. But mm-hmm. should probably reflect a bit more on that.
Okay, fair enough. Yeah. So in IR, no, not just in IR, also from Fenimore's perspective, I think she would call herself a constructivist. That's her identity. She's associated with constructivism. Much of the work that she has done has been to illustrate what constructivism does, what norms do, how norms operate. In her work on international organizations as teachers of norms, for example, she very much draws on constructivist ideas about the spread of norms, about learning, about international organizations as agents, right? Kirsha.
But then, doesn't the fact that she's a constructivist influence her writing in sociological institutionalism to seem like constructivist? But then if you weren't reading Fenimore, we're reading somewhere else, would we still question that?
Right. Good point. I mean, the question, I think, and it's a very legitimate question that you are raising, is the world culture school, the sociological institutionalism that she discusses in that article, is that constructivism? Right? The problem we run into a little bit is that constructivism is a body of literature that has meaning within the field of international relations. So if you would talk to a sociologist and you would say somebody is a constructivist or not a constructivist, that term is not as meaningful. It is associated very often with Berger and Luckmann and the social construction of reality, but in a way, from a political science perspective, all sociologists in a way are constructivists, right? Because they're all thinking about the influence of society, social facts in Durkheim's sense, social action in Weber's sense, are so fundamental to what sociologists are doing. Yet, and I think, Kersha, you're onto something really important here, and I think you're actually in a way speaking with Finnemore, who says, well, that kind of a theory is actually structuralist to begin with, right? So they are assuming that there is such a thing as a world culture, which is quite an argument to make, right? If there's really anarchy, then assuming world culture doesn't make any sense. If there is international institutions, what do you say? If you are an English school person, what would you think about the idea that there is world culture? Would it make sense? Might make sense, right? But there's different actors here that are specified, right? The world culture school really goes below the state and assumes that there is a spread of ideas of justice, of efficiency, of bureaucracy, of a particular form of economy that is not just at the level of states. They're actually in their work go quite beyond that. They look at state bureaucracies. They also look at non-governmental organizations and things of that nature. So they're not as hung up on the state as maybe the English school would be. I would like to go to, I think it was Laurie's question on the content of what the World Culture School proposes. What's the number of the question? Question five? All right, let's look at question five. Is rationality a feature of Western culture, or is that a Eurocentric view? Maybe you should reformulate that again, what you have in mind here.
Yeah, well, she argues that rationality was spread throughout the world as a part of the Western culture, and that's why bureaucracies developed around the world. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking, I mean, she assumes that rationality is only is only part of Western culture, but I mean that's kind of Eurocentric because probably many other cultures had rational mm-hmm. bureaucracies way before Europe and the West mm-hmm. Had it. So I was mm-hmm. I was thinking maybe it's more about a modernist version of it, of the world, and that we need more rationality because of technical complexity and all these kind of arguments.
But that's exactly what she contests, right?
I know, yeah.
That's exactly what she contests. She says it's not a functional, it's not an element of a functional necessity that these bureaucracies and the economy in the form that we know it develops, but that it is precisely one of a cultural spread. I think the interesting question that you're asking is, well, where does that world culture come from? Mm-hmm. right? And is the, do all good things and all bad things originate in the West? How does international culture actually get constituted? And if you would look into some of the writings that are going on in anthropology and on transnational, the formation of transnational cultures and so on, the issues of hybridity of culture, there's actually a very massive contestation of that idea that the culture spreads kind of from a center of culture to then encompass the whole rest of the world. This is, of course, a bias that comes a little bit also from Weberian sociology and the idea that there is a kind of an evolution of modernity, and modernity has a particular phase, and that phase is very much Western. So picking up on these other elements of culture or other cultures and the interaction of cultures, frankly, that has happened throughout world history is something that is not in there. So there is, I think you're right, there is a certain Eurocentric bias in this particular theory. All right. So I would like to then move on to question 11. Is sociological institutionalism effective in challenging liberalism? Who asked that question? Kershia, that was also you. Introduce us what you had in mind here, to what you had in mind here.
Okay, so I started by realizing that Fenimore assumes that similar organizational forms and political goals are adopted around the world in aspects of economic growth and social justice. But then this theory doesn't challenge whether these mechanisms are effective everywhere. She just states that they exist and they're adopted by the rest of the states. So with the existence of countries in dire poverty and they do not see any future economic growth or involvement of violence, can these examples challenge her idea that sociological institutionalism does question liberalism mm-hmm. in IR.
Mm-hmm. Does she actually say that it questions liberalism?
Well, in her introduction, she says that sociologists working in organization theory have developed a particular powerful set of arguments about the roles of norms and culture in international life that pose direct challenges to realist and liberal theories in political science.
All right, okay. So I think the way I would read that is that it's a challenge to ideas of liberal institutionalism. In other words, to the interest-based theories that we just reviewed a minute ago. I don't think what she is saying, and I don't think it would be tenable actually, that this, the idea of world culture poses a question to liberalism more broadly, because in a sense one could actually say that world culture is profoundly liberal, because it is about equality, human rights, and all of those good things that emanate supposedly from the West. So I don't think that's intended. Right? But there's two levels to your question, right? So you want to come back?
You said you don't think it's intended, but isn't she accountable for everything she writes?
Yeah, no, but okay, but not if you're misreading her what she is thinking. I don't know. Did anybody else read it the way Kershaw read it? I think it's actually a misreading of what her argument is. But there's something else in your intervention which I think is interesting, and that is the question: is this diffusion really happening in the way in which she's describing it, and what actually is diffusing given the reality of poverty, inequality, and whatnot in many countries of the South? How can one claim, looking at how diverse and unequal the world is today, that there is such a thing as a world culture that is diffusing, because what we are essentially saying is a lot of inequality and difference around the world. I think that was in your question also, right? And that, I think, is an interesting question.
Yeah, but my question is all the way wrong. I'm saying that.
Take the microphone, Adam.
Yeah, my question is that.
Your question was the question number four? No?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
So, according to Finimot, she was trying to argue against the sociologist that cultural norms are transferred by force or something. And so they are not just things that, they are not norms that countries just, you know, attach themselves to. But I just want to say that most countries of the world, even from the South, are becoming westernized. Mm-hmm. So, and it's not by force.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
I don't think it's right for mm-hmm. her to say it's by force.
Okay, so. Okay. So we have two people with Laurie in the back and, remind me of your name.
Katie,
yes, Katie, sorry.
I had similar thoughts to this because in her writing, she claims that sociological institutionalism marginalizes power and politics. And I didn't necessarily catch that. I think it's more concerned with the way change is occurring without those obvious uses of force or that obvious power, like she said. There is an occurrence of westernization, and it's not all about going and enforcing change.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there is something to be said about that, that it doesn't necessarily marginalize power, but it emphasizes that change can exist without that very coercive, obvious use of violence.
Okay. So you're actually defending her. You mm-hmm. this sounds kind of right to you, right? So there is change that is happening, and isomorphisms, that term, that are happening without power. Laurie, what do you think?
Yeah, I was thinking in some way there are coercions that can be explained by when she talks about states and how everybody needed to have a state, because if you don't have a state, then internationally you're not recognized and you can't deal with others.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
So in a sense, they have to adopt a Western form of the state.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not maybe by violence, but it's a kind of coercion in that sense. So, I mean, I think she kind of deals with both.
Right. So it's precisely the power of ideas,
mm-hmm.
norms,
yeah.
culture, and so on that invites us, that hails us to, hails other states to organize themselves in the same way as others. Let me just make one observation of in this discussion also. Let's not make the mistake of associating politics with violence. So to say that these sociological institutionalists are ignoring politics, including power politics, yes, she says that, I agree, doesn't necessarily mean that they're just ignoring the fact that there is capabilities of force or threat that's behind that. Politics is a lot more, right? It's the kind of the positioning oneself vis-a-vis other people's interests, the negotiating, the seeking advantage, the working things out on the basis of pursuing interests, and that is something different that doesn't necessarily need force. It may need influence. It may need rhetoric. It may need persuasion. It may need also games of negotiation and things of that nature. So all of that is politics. And I think what she is saying is that sociological institutionalists don't think about that at all. So the suggestion in that theory is precisely this idea that there are certain forms and they're diffusing. And so therefore all they can see, this is about method in a way, right? Go back to our discussion as to how do we know what we know. What they are finding is particular correlations also tracked over time. So these forms are diffusing, they can track that, but they can't actually, in a sense, say how that happens. You know, why is it that, countries that don't have any connection to the ocean have a navy. How did that come about? Right? What kind of discussions were going on internally in that country when they decided to set up a Department of the Navy? They may not have a navy, but they have a Department of the Navy. So there's something, there's some meaning to that in some way. And it actually might be interesting to look into the politics of how that got established. All right. Somebody had a question, but which one was that? About the question 8. Katharina, that was you. What was your question here? Can you reformulate that again?
Yes. It was based on the assumption that, Finnemar say that international organization may determine what state are, especially in the European Union organization. Mm-hmm. And I was just thinking that maybe it's too much like top down mm-hmm. as an assumption. Mm. So mm-hmm. that was my question. If it's
okay. Again, I find that there's two levels in that question. You know, there's first of all the question, is it really meaningful to say that international organizations create states or give meaning to that entity state? And then there's the hierarchy question, the top-down question.
Because it seems like a state is legitimized, let's say, just because it's inside an international organization. Like that was appeared to me.
Okay, so that's the international law approach, states needing to be recognized. But there's something else going on here that I think is worth pointing out. So when we think about international institutions from a rationalist perspective, or liberal institutionalism, what do institutions do? From a rationalist perspective, institutions constrain. They provide the environment and then they direct people's actions in particular directions. Right? So they're limiting entities. They make it so that everybody doesn't just do whatever they want to do, but instead it directs them. It gives them incentives to operate in a particular direction. Sociological institutionalism adds to that a different conception, namely the idea that institutions also are constitutive of objects. And this is very much constructivist, and you have encountered this before. So rules, norms, social forms, they don't just confine us and direct us to do certain things. They're not just regulative, but they're also constitutive. They create particular objects as meaningful. They establish actors as by empowering them, by telling them it is reasonable and you are authorized and meaningful for you to actually act as an actor, for me to stand up here and lecture to you, right? You had to be constituted as that person who is actually empowered to do so. If Guilherme came up here and said, I'm gonna do it today, you would have questions about it. The rules are such that he is not being constituted as a professor. So this constitutive element, tough luck, sorry. This constitutive element of what institutions are doing, I think, is very distinctive to sociological institutionalism. And so then also the kinds of questions that it can answer as a result is why, who is a meaningful actor? How do human rights start to matter, right? And what kind of objects are being constituted in international discourse within international organizations? So it's not just about states, but also meaningful things that are being constituted through institutions.
and in this particular context, the human rights institutions. That doesn't answer entirely your question, right? Because you had actually a doubt about locating so much of this constitutive power entirely at the level of international organizations. I'd like to just bring us back a little bit to the distinction we made also in the beginning of the class between constructivism as an ontology or a worldview and theories. Right? And I used to, and I'm repeating this again, that for the most part, constructivism is not a theory, but it is a view about the world. And so the idea that rules are constitutive is intrinsic to constructivism. Now, to then make a theory out of that, and this is what you're criticizing, right, that institutionalists are saying that it's international institutions that are primarily constitutive of this object we call the state, it's something that can actually be criticized. It's something there is evidence that this is not sufficient, right? That being a state, you need all kinds of other things. You need internal legitimacy. There has to be population. There has to be territory. There has to be all these other things that are internal to the state. It doesn't do away with the overall notion that institutions are constitutive, but we can't immediately draw the conclusion that it's international institutions, that that is a theory that explains the constitution of the state. So there's just a caution to keep that distinction in mind. Okay, I think let's move on to Ruggie's article. Where do we start here? If we start with the US elections, we're never going to get anywhere else. So let's not start there. Why don't we start give me a should we start with seven? Okay, let's start with seven.
Okay. Sure, that's mine.
Okay. Nicolas, you know, totally disinterested here, making a good suggestion. Go ahead.
Now, okay, so what I was thinking is that Ruggie's like embedded liberalism clearly entails the Western rationality and individualism can be seen as core elements of like global culture and sociological institutionalist thought. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, I think in Ruggie's account, we can clearly identify agency, whereas in sociological institutionalism, I don't think there's such a thing as agency. Just like this global culture is just there, and yeah. We don't know where it comes from.
Yeah,
because they say that that Western rationality, individualism, they kind of create states and they create markets, and so on. But they don't really mm-hmm. say what creates this this rationality and so on.
So you're saying that they would actually be a good complement, or Ruggie is almost a corrective to sociological institutionalism?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's what I think.
Okay. So the first thing we have to do to make that a value proposition is to say that world culture and international regimes somehow overlap or are almost the same, right? Which... for the moment, I don't think there is an a priori reason to reject that proposition. You said that Ruggie introduces agents. Who are the agents?
Well, he doesn't do so explicitly, I think. Mm-hmm. But like what he explains is that, you know, there was a driver of this whole embedded liberalism, and I think we can definitely assume that, like, the United States was a key actor there, you know, with this whole Bretton Woods agreement and so on. Though I think there is agency there.
Okay.
So we have states as agents, and certainly hegemonic states.
Exactly, yes, economic hegemonic states.
Yeah, but there's more there. There's other agents as well. I mean, this is not a purely state-centric theory. Anybody? Who are the other agents in the background here? No? Jeremy.
Well, let's start with the obvious one, the international institutions. Better saying
international
the
institutions.
If we see them as like constellations of norms, you know, and
are they actors? Do they appear as actors in this?
Well, is there any difference between being an actor, being an agent, like the ability
okay,
to?
Okay, that's all right. Actors or agents. That's not the distinction I meant to.
I think they may be agents in the embedded liberalism. In fact, one of my discarded questions would be if the case could be made for Ruggie to be an early adopter of strong cognitivism, as per Hayes and Claver.
Of cognitivism. Uh-huh.
Strong cognitivism.
Strong cognitivism, yeah, okay. Remind us as to what that is.
Oh, boy. Okay, so... when you talked about knowledge-based approaches, you cited Corrine and Goldstein, Haas, both Haases. Fenimore, to an extent, although Fenimore may veer closer toward strong cognitivism, but I don't know if by option you didn't make the distinction that Heather Claver and his peers make in the article between weak cognitivists and strong cognitivists. And I'd argue that... The authors you listed may be assigned to the weak cognitivist camp, mm-hmm. insofar as they still have and I think it dovetails to what I think Kusha said, that they still think in rational terms. They still depart from a rationalist ontology, mm-hmm. And also they don't see. Regimes as constituting states. That's actually maybe a good argument for the charge that, not the charge, but labeling Ruggie as an early adopter of stronger cognitivism, that embedded liberalism, I'd argue, I interpret it as such, can be seen as constituting states to an extent.
Uh-huh.
So in that sense, and just to all go right. back to your question, institutions have agency.
Okay.
Ooh, okay.
Okay, thank you. So
thanks.
So your argument being that Ruggie's type of cognitivism or constructivism or institutionalism goes beyond thinking of ideas or regimes as kind of facilitating rational action. Which is what a lot of the other theories that I listed there are doing. And he goes one step further.
Yeah.
To him, you call that, they call that, Haas and Claver and so call that strong cognitivism. Cognitivism or really, I think what's important here is not so much cognitivism, but the idea that the world is ordered, ruled, sociologically ruled by norms throughout is the starting point of his analysis. And so therefore you conclude international organizations are agents. That's a jump, okay? Well, one can make that argument, and I'm sure you could if I pushed you. I actually don't think that's the argument that's in that article, at least. I think Ruggie really thinks of international institutions as outcomes of particular processes, or he treats them here as outcomes of particular processes. And the reason I am... let's not talk about agents or actors for a moment. Let's just put that in the background. What is he saying? How are regimes being created and what is underlying changes in regimes? What's this basic theory? And he very much sets it up as against power-based explanations, I think. Anybody? Laurie? Do we have oh, you have it. Great.
I guess he would argue that changes are either norm-governed or norm... I don't remember the term, but like if the norms change or if the instruments don't really... reflect the norms, so then it results in regime change.
Yeah, so you have that issue of norm-governed change, you know, which focuses mostly on the norms actually staying the same, but then you have a change in mechanisms. But is that, what's the underlying force in this? I mean, if you go into changes beyond norm-governed changes, Guillermo.
Legitimate social purpose?
Legitimate social purpose. We haven't heard this before, right? Nobody really talks about that. This is it's a very runny thing, right? Social purpose. Why does he bring this in? What does he have in mind? What does he introduce here that other theories of international relations are not dealing with? Nicholas, you have a...
Well, maybe, I don't know.
Yeah. You look like you have something in mind.
What I think what Ruggie is saying is that it kind of happens when, like, well, especially like Bretton Woods and like this embedded liberalism happened when it was tried to reconcile like the free trade with like the requirements and the needs of the social actors within the states.
Yeah.
Basically, and
he just said actors.
Yeah.
Right? That's what I was trying to get at. Ruggie actually is opening up the state, and he's saying the state is not just a unitary actor that has interests or whatnot and is negotiating these interests in the international arena, but there's a social purpose behind what states are doing. And implied in that is, of course, that there's internal contestations among actors within states that create that social purpose. Why did you have a laissez-faire liberalism in the 19th century? It's in part because there was a middle class that was established through processes of industrialization. And that middle class and the merchant class and the liberal exporters actually benefited from having a free trade regime of the type that the Brits established in the 19th century. So the social purpose, it was not just the purpose of the state as wanting to accumulate power in or securing power or securing stability or whatnot in the international arena that drove the establishment of that regime, but there was something that happened internally in the state. And since we're talking about economic regimes, he's interested in economic regimes, he's focusing on the way in which economic relations of production, dare I say, using a Marxist term, the way in which relations of productions have been changing over time. And with that, there have been changes in the way in which international flows are happening, international transactions are happening. He has this beautiful analysis, I think, of pointing out that so much of the international trade in the 19th century was actually cross-continental trade. And even though we're talking about globalization not being new, because globalization also was a feature of the 19th century, of the turn of the 19th to 20th century, and there may have been even more trade than we have today, but much of the trade today is fundamentally different in that it is intra-sectoral trade and that it is trade within international companies. So internal trade, trade also that is, you have a lot of trade within Europe, in addition to outside Europe. But the new phenomenon really is this very, very heavy intra-regional trade. So even though we're talking about trade in the 19th century and trade in the 20th century as if it were the same thing, it is actually not the same thing. And underlying it are different social purposes. And the one social purpose that has fundamentally changed between the 19th century and the 20th century is that domestic stability, employment generation, came onto the agenda as something that states wanted to accomplish. And if you want to accomplish that, which the Brits in the 19th century, that just was not a crucial concern in the way in which they structured their international relations. But it became a crucial concern in the 20th century. And if you make that a crucial concern, that is going to affect the kind of international regimes that are being generated. And so then this suggestion that the regimes of the 20th century were not the pure liberalism of the 19th century, but it was an embedded kind of liberalism that always sought to control the international flows, in particular financial flows, having stability in the financial system, and regulating trade so that one can make sure it does not affect negatively domestic stability. And that is the new social purpose. So what you have then is you actually have, what does that have to do with international regimes, right? So it's not like international regimes had to be created so that then they constrain what states should be doing. Instead, in a way, you have these international regimes providing what Ruggie calls the permissive environment for states to be able to fulfill their social purpose. So they're actually kind of, the focus shifts almost, right? The focus shifts from international relations to domestic relations to ensuring a particular form of welfare, well-being, stability, what he calls social purpose. We haven't had that in any of the theories that we read so far. We haven't had this idea that that there is, I would almost say, a material foundation to these international regimes. I mean, it's interesting because Ruggie doesn't actually use Marxist language at all. Right? I mean, he doesn't talk about relations of production. He does not talk about social forces, which is another one of those Marxist terms. But it's clearly something you can read into his type of argument. There is something that has to happen in the economic sphere that then is paralleled by, do I dare, the superstructure that is generated in the international arena. So regimes kind of more as a superstructure that reflects and allows, that doesn't, I shouldn't push this too far, right? Because he's not thinking of regimes as purely kind of an outcome of the interests of the dominant class or something like that. He does talk about a common social purpose that is being generated in domestic arenas. So, Kirshia, now.
How do you think Ruggie would respond to Brexit?
How would Ruggie respond to Brexit? Now, next thing, we're going to go to the American elections. Okay. You're not going to make me answer this. I'm going to throw this back at you. So I would like to ask Guilherme how he thinks Ruggie would answer to Brexit. Now let's throw this out. I mean, this is really, we're talking about, and I think we have to talk here about the tension, is this norm-governed change? I think that's what you're asking, I mean, in Ruggie's terms. Or is this a change of the regime, Are we looking at a change of the underlying fundamentals? Germa, that's exactly what you were going to say, right?
Well, yeah, actually, I included Brexit in my question, but, you know, since the U.S. still the hegemon and all that, I prefer to provide justification, because actually, I spend the better part of the my remarks trying to come up with a hypothesis for that, and, you know, it may apply to the U.K. as well, in as much as the legitimate social purpose may be seen as changing. I mean, of course, you know, deporting people, disregard for environmental regulations may not initially be seen given, you know, history, at least for the past 50 years, as legitimate social purpose. But, you know, if it's democratically backed, then you have the question also, the opening up of the state, right? You begin to analyze interest groups and, you know, and their, well, interests.
Right. Okay, so you see there may be a change in the social purpose of the state, and it has to do with environmental issues. Nicholas?
Not particularly environmental issues.
Not only.
But no, yeah, because... Well, I actually tried to unite, you know, Fenimore's conceptualization of progress v. justice. And, you know, in a very simple terms, you can say that progress may be prioritized now.
May be prioritized now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
To the detriment Let's of, see. You know, equality.
Right. Nicolas, what do you think?
Well, I think, like, this legitimate social purpose is not really changing, but I think it's rather that this tension between free trade and the social purpose is much higher than it was before. And so the social actors, they kind of push back against this this free trade. And that's why we see like such phenomena as Brexit and Trump being elected president, because Trump has repeatedly said that he will abolish NAFTA and things like that. And that's typically like free trade.
Yep.
And he wants to do that because he wants to strengthen like this social purpose of the state, I think.
He's re-establishing the social purpose of the state.
Yes, exactly.
So
yes.
Brexit re-establishing the social purpose of the state, the protection of people. Guillermo doesn't like this.
No, yeah, I actually listed, you know, protectionism as one of the, well, the arguments for this shift in legitimate social purpose. But, you know, it just seems a bit weak. But there's all this narrative that, you know, the people who are promoting these changes are globalization's losers. You know, there's talk of the 30% or 40%, yeah, or whatever you want to call it. But, I mean, can you really oppose things that's not, you know, getting better jobs? Because, well, on the downside, people are not going to be able, especially poor people, are not going to be able to have access to, you know, cheaper products. But can you really oppose the, well, whatever advantages you might extract from that? From, you know, deporting people, which is an ingrained wish in you know, maybe the majority of the people who voted for these changes, and also, you know, yeah, trampling over environmental regulations and to that extent, really ignoring the future generations.
Yeah, what about that?
Their rights to.
Well, yeah. How does xenophobia, sexism, racism relate to legitimate social purpose? Is what you're saying?
Oh, well, I think it's just a matter of perception. I think the people are just conflating all the issues together. So, yeah.
What do you mean by that? People are just conflating all issues together?
Yeah, it's just like immigration, things like that. They just think it's all the same, you know. It's all. Okay.
So in a way, you say that's secondary, or speaking through Ruggie's theory, right? There is, in a way, actually has nothing to say about that particular aspect.
Yeah.
Of what things are about, because he's talking about economic issues and he's talking about economic regimes, right? So I mean, I think if you recall, I think somewhere in the conclusion of that article, he actually says something like, and this is an old article, right? It's from what, 1982 or something, right? He's actually saying something that if there is going to be a change in social purpose, it's going to be rung in by the current phase of neoliberalism. So this is the early 1980s. This is Ronald Reagan starting his presidency, Margaret Thatcher coming into power in the UK. And that's what he is seeing, right? He is seeing actually with neoliberal economic orthodoxies, seeing that there is something that is shifting. We're now at a stage where maybe it's actually shifting back. It's not going to be the same thing necessarily as the 1950s, 1960s, because certain agreed protections like collective bargaining, like labor protections, have been really questioned. The notion of that you need a flexible labor market, that there has to be some balance there, that has changed. Unions are not what they used to be in terms of strength. So there's something that has changed, right? Even the notion of employment protection, you know, has changed, I think. So there's something may have changed. So the question is a little bit as to what is going to come back there, right? Christelle, did you want to come in on this?
On Regis, and I've just skimmed, I came across an article that he wrote recently, and he is following up on the embedded liberalism, and he is writing about the backlash of globalization and how this is the effect of globalization with the intensification of inequalities is creating a disjunction between the economic regimes and the social purposes. So. Yeah, and I can circulate the chapter.
That'd be very interesting. It would be great if we could share that. We can put it up on Moodle, right? So there is, there's not just the decline of the hegemon, he would say, right? So, and we had this discourse in international relations since the 1970s, 1980s, that the U.S. is declining as a hegemon because of the changes in the economic regimes, in particular in the monetary regime. But we may actually be seeing something that is shifting in that material basis that he calls social purpose, which may be happening before our eyes. And so then regime change or the decline of a regime may be something that is in the offing there. I think that might be a good enough interpretation. All right, so which questions have we not covered here? Who will bear the costs of embedded liberalism? That was Kershia, right? Also, no? It sounds like a Kershia question. Was it yours? Okay. Guilherme.
Well, yeah, actually, this one is, you know, just a segue to whatever we've gathered from Ruggie. He said that whenever, you know, there's a menacing change, the actors and institutions rearrange themselves so as to assign costs of status quo to the particular groups. Mm-hmm. So I was wondering, which group would this fall upon now?
Yeah.
If this doesn't, you know, imply a norm transforming change.
Yeah. I mean, we're obviously going to read the tea leaves here, but I think there is some suggestions that he made about who bore the costs of embedded liberalism was inflation. Through inflation, you actually externalize some costs.
Private markets. And regime takers.
Regime takers, which are basically those who don't make the regimes, but then have to submit themselves to the regime, weaker states, third world states. And what's this? There was something else. No, there was
private markets.
Private markets, aha. Private markets, yeah, the creation of kind of the private finance that has taken over and done some of the funding that needed to be done. in order to have balances of payment confirmed. So those were the ones that were bearing, or those were the ways to externalize the costs, I think is how he puts that, in under embedded liberalism. What is going to be happening there in as we go forward? We had Nicholas. Why don't we let Nicholas answer that first?
I think we can make a link there with Wallerstein's theory about world systems, where basically, well, I don't have it very present in mind, but I think he says that there's a core and periphery,
yep,
and the core exploits the periphery economically, and I think that's basically what embedded liberalism is doing.
Right. So, but depending on what if we have a shift in social purpose and new regimes, hard to know whether that is going to be repeated, right, or whether through the creation of protectionist arrangements around the world, maybe you don't need to externalize. Everybody does their own thing. That's the other extreme. Right. No more trade. Guilherme, go for it.
No, yeah, if I just might add, the question may be who will bear the cost, but if we shift it to who bears the cost now, then this may dovetail to the narrative of the losers of globalization. You know, it's actually an interesting topic because, the world has never been that as rich as it is now, but inequality has been also rising, you know, wealth concentration and all that. But the thing is, if we are to link it also to, relative perception of power, these people are usually white, unskilled workers, or at least not that qualified. You know, they have, even if they have, if their income has increased, they are, what they're seen as it's a relative downfall in their both social and economic position with regard to, you know, groups who used to be subaltern.
But the problem here is precisely that the costs haven't been externalized anymore, or that the externalization of cost hasn't worked because they had to absorb the cost in a sense. And that is what undermines the social purpose, right?
If I can just finish, I was wondering if these same people who, you know, enjoyed great progress during the last years will be the ones upon which the costs will fall, maybe via inflation.
Maybe via inflation. Yeah. Maybe, right? I mean, the difficulty is of predicting anything along those lines in the absence of... if we're really in the middle of massive change, you know, we might be able to have an explanation of various options, and this is one option, but there's no way of knowing. Okay.
Yeah, and if I just might add to Nicholas' point, I think his perspective, Wallerstein's perspective, would be one of the costs being assigned to regime takers.
Yeah.
Insofar as the system persists.
That's always an easy one. Exactly. Okay, then we have one other question here. This is question three. Intersubjectively shared social purposes, can they be understood as shared interests? Damilola, was that you? No, that was you.
Well, according to my view of Reggie's perception.
Yeah.
First of all, he perceives social purposes as being constant in his own analysis.
Mm.
Being constant. So I got, therefore giving them a focal point of focus of being very, very vital,
mm-hmm,
in trying to create a balance of power and norms.
Yep.
Balance of power and norms. So I was wondering, can intersubjectively shared social purposes be understood as shared interests of these
shared interests shared by individuals, by groups, by states?
By states, yeah.
By states. Uh-huh. I do think that that's his point, right? So it's not just, I mean, I've kind of focused in this analysis just a minute ago mostly on the idea that there is internal purpose, but when he talks about shared purpose, he is actually saying that this purpose, which I think you correctly identify as static, that's correct, right? Because it's that purpose of employment, of stability, employment generation internally, that that purpose is shared across a number of states. So it's important for most states that participate in regimes that they would share that social purpose. And again, there's a certain element of Gramscian Marxism, I think, in this, of suggesting that hegemony is established not only by imposing certain rules from the outside, but also by projecting an internal agreement, an internal order to the international arena. So to the extent that there is an agreement among OECD countries, for example, and the OECD does that very extensively to have the economy stable in some sense, and the OECD does provides information extensively on precisely this question of internal stability, whether it's regarding agriculture or whether regarding other economic indicators. So to the extent you have that, you can also then have more easily the provision of international norms and the creation of international regimes. So I think you're saying something important here by reminding us that shared social purpose is not just shared internally, but it is actually shared internationally across states. And it's that sharing that's relevant for thinking about the establishment of international regimes. All right. So I think we are pretty much through. Am I missing something? Why didn't the international trade regime fall as predicted by hegemonic stability theory? Was that you also? Yes, okay, does that connect?
I think as loud thinking, because after reading, then I realized, well, he predicted that maybe, according to my understanding, the theory predicts that the international trade regime would fall. So why didn't it then fall?
So you're saying after, why didn't it fall in the 1970s, 1980s? When you had kind of protectionism going on the books again. We actually had the contrary, because after that we actually had the creation of the WTO, which was after Ruggie wrote this. So rather than actually it falling, it got strengthened. But what would Ruggie's answer be? Ruggie's answer would be, well, the social purpose hasn't changed, right? And so basically, you know, you had to work this through the instruments. This was norm-governed change, right, which was his argument. This is not a really major change in the regime. We're talking about norm-governed change. The norm is staying the same. The instruments are changing. And that's because the socially underlying social purpose, the agreement on the social purpose of the international regime, still existed in the end of the 20th century. Let me finish with one observation. There's one thing that came up in our discussion that I would like you to keep in the back of your mind, and that was the discussion about the American elections and the function of who wins and who loses, and of xenophobia, racism, sexism, and all of those things. We haven't so far dealt with any theories that take seriously those kind of phenomena that are not immediately either rationally Western, right, or rational in a sense of instrumental for the advancement of the state. Yeah. And we need to be alert to that. I think we're going to be dealing with some theories that actually will talk about what makes a state where are the boundaries of the state, the constitution of the state. Those are theories that are more post-structuralist theories that talk about state identity, the imagined image of what a citizen is, who belongs and who doesn't belong, and makes that also important as we're talking about international affairs. So just keep that in the back of your mind, Nicholas, in a sense, I disagree with you, as that it's just a big confusion, right? But I don't think we right now have actually good instruments to conceptualize these phenomena as phenomena of international relations. So thank you very much. Excellent discussion, as always, and I see you next week. I think everybody has submitted their book reviews, right? This is a minor side here. Wonderful. I look forward to reading them. See you then.
You don't need this, right? The list of questions or anything? Okay. Hey, how are you? Oh, thanks. Yeah, I need to bring
you
to the guy.
I
saw it last night. Yeah, no worries about it. Yeah.
So, yeah. Keep on working then.
Yeah, just send it when you have it ready.
Yeah, sure. And also, I wanted to know if it would be all right for me to. Like, I was thinking that. No, maybe you. I think this was my best participation because I based it on questions.
Uh-huh.
So maybe I could write like questions for the last classes that I haven't been on, just to have something to submit.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. Yeah.
I don't have
also
participation.
For sure. Yeah, yeah. We should also talk to Professor Frugel about this since she's here now.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, I don't see any problem, but just to have her.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Sure. Yeah, thanks.
Nice.
Oh, by the way, you completely forgot about the Georgian company.
Yeah.
What's
yeah.
the name?
Oh.
You remember?
Armenia.
Oh, Armenia.
It's called City Bugs.
City Bugs.
City Bugs, yeah. I'll send you the link. I'll send it to you on Facebook.
Yeah. No, because my boss was actually here this week.
Oh, yeah? Oh, yeah, yeah, I'll send it to you. I'll send it to you as I get back to the office.
And I mentioned, was it because he was in the Czech Republic presenting
okay.
an event in Prague?
Uh-huh.
And, he just made a quick stop here.
So are you still working? Are you still working?
In Brazil, yeah, it was very, very hard. I think I got ill because of that, because I had to do so much in so little time.
Yeah, yeah, I know. It was really hard for a startup.
Yeah, and there's this mentality of making mistakes as fast as possible, which is a struggle to adapt because, I'm kind of a slow thinker. I tend to think of myself, can you come up something quick fast? But till I'm happy with what I have, it might take a while. But then I have to completely abandon this.
Yeah. I have this thing. If you give me like 15 minutes to come,
no, you will be, but you won't just be happy about it.
Yeah. Yeah.
But
just think, get these back to the conversation.
Yeah, yeah. Interesting. Yeah, in the sense of unstable.
I have no idea where to leave the mics because the guy is gone. So
just leave them in the front.
Okay.